Back in the days, the Sufiyah were not the same, by the way. They were not all the same, as Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentions. From the Sufis, were Fudayl ibn Iyad. Fudayl ibn Iyad was from the Sufiyah, Aimat al-Sufiyah. Ibrahim ibn Adham was from the Aimat al-Sufiyah. Sulaiman al-Darani is from the Aimat al-Sufiyah. But they were different. Junaid was from Aimat al-Sufiyah. The Sufiyah, they went through phases. They changed as time went by. The ones before, they were aesthetic, zuhad. They left this world and they were towards the Akhirah. They were zuhad. Are you there? And they were more about living a simple life in this world. Okay, just to be aesthetic, not to be a person of this dunya. They were ones who used to carry عظمون النصوص الوحيين. They used to honor the textual evidence. Abu Junaid, one of the statements that was, Sulaiman al-Darani is a student of Abu Junaid. Junaid, one of the statements that was transmitted from him was that he said, I sometimes hear a person say a benefit and I don't write it. Atawakaf, I withhold. And I say to that person, what witness do you have that goes in accordance to this benefit that you mentioned? Do you have an ayah or the hadith for it? Are you with me? But as time went by, the Sufis changed, especially when the time of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali came. When Abu Hamid al-Ghazali came, what he did was, he emerged the Sufiyah with Ash'ariyah. Sah? Ash'ariyah and Sufiyah emerged towards one another. Back in the days, Ash'ariyah and the Sufiyah were two different things, they were two entities. After Abi Hamid al-Ghazali onwards, you'd rarely find an Ash'ari, except he's a Sufi, he's one of the Turuq al-Sufiyah, one of the Brelwiyah or Naqshbandiyah or whatever, Qadiriyah, whatever it may be, he is a Tariq min Turuq al-Sufiyah. But his aqidah is aqidah al-Ash'ari, or is a Maturidi mathalan. Are you with me? So, then they adopted things which were shirkiyat, at-tawassul bil-awliya, you know, doing tawassul, intercession through the righteous people. They started to adopt these things. These were not common amongst the early generation of the Sufiyah. They didn't have that stuff. They never fell into those major shirk statements that you find the later Sufiyah falling into. And then after, as time went on, they started to pass on beliefs that this world that we're in today, their awliya played a role in its building. That they helped Allah with the spreading of the sama and the spreading of this earth and etc. Statements which were very, very dangerous. Like Bursiri, what he said in his statement, وَإِنَّ مِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عُلْمُ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ. That Muhammad, this world that we're in today is from your generosity. You're the one who gave it to us. It's part of your generosity. And also, from your knowledge is what's written on the Lawhul Mahfuz. What's written on the Lawhul Mahfuz is from the knowledge which you know. Are you with me? And where the Sufiyah took this from was the Shia. They connected themselves too much with the Tashayyu'. Shia came and they slipped this into them. Are you there, brothers? And so istighatha and tawassul, it entered onto them. Are you with me, brothers? So, the name Sufiyah, they say that the Sufiyah comes from Ahlul Sufa, the people that used to live in the Prophet's masjid, Abu Hurairah and the likes of him, who used to live in the masjid. But the strongest opinion, Ibn Taymiyyah says that no. Sufiyah came from, they used to wear Suf. That's the kind of clothes that they used to wear, Suf, which is cotton. Back in those days, cotton was looked down at. It wasn't one of the best clothes. So they used to wear unappealing clothing. They weren't attractive. They were Zahideen. Then they started to introduce dancing and music, and now which so many people don't understand, but call anashid. Anashid came from the Sufiyah. They're the ones who brought it. That this is a spiritual uplifting for them. That when they sing and they dance, it's something not you won't understand. Or it's a spiritual uplifting. So they sing, they dance, okay? They started to adopt these concepts as well. It started to creep into them. So they will dance. And now if you see them, they go in circles, they swell and whatnot. Huh? This is ibadah for them. And adhkar and dhikrs that are really strange. Like instead of saying Allah, they say Allahu, 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 hu, 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 hu. Just who? They take the dhamir of ha. Who, let's go fast, just saying all day, and that's a dhikr for them. Sah? All of those were things that they started to adopt and things that they started to do. So, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah took after them, right? It so that And at his time, there was a Taif group called Rafi'i, the Rafi'i group, who used to claim that they could walk through fire, it wouldn't burn them. You see, they used to claim this stuff and show the people that this is the kind of people they are, the awliya of Allah. So Ibn Taymiyyah took it to every level with them. Shara'an, he debated with them. Aqlan, in rationality, he destroyed them. When nothing would work and they still were stubborn on their beliefs, he said, how about this? We all go into the fire together. Let's get ready. You guys go into the fire, I, Shaykh al-Islam, I, Ibn Taymiyyah, will also go in the fire with you guys, but with condition. He knew that they used to put on some things on, which when they went into the fire, it wouldn't really burn them. Huh? Inflammatory stuff, huh? Which they would put on so that it won't burn them. So he said, I'll give you vinegar. Ibn Taymiyyah says, you have to shower with vinegar, khal. That will get rid of everything. We all go into the fire. And we'll see who it burns. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ They lost them. They know what to say. So Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah exposed them in every different levels and every different angles. عليه رحمة. When they refused to go into the fire, he said, okay, how about this? Just put the khal on your finger and put it to the fire. Just a finger. They refused to. عليه رحمة الله. Just a finger. Burn your finger and I'll do it with you. I'm with you. I'll do it with you. No. They got exposed for what they were upon. So they started to adopt this belief, which is that وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ That there's a level which you reach, it's called certainty, it's called the certainty level. Which once you reach that level, you don't worship Allah anymore. Salah is not wajib on you, zakat is not wajib on you. All the takalif shara'iyya, the jurisprudent rulings, the things that were wajibat, the muharramat, are not haram from you. So you see some of the Sufi leaders, you see that they marry their own daughters, they marry their own parents. Common, no haram. There's no muharramat. حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ None of that is haram for them anymore. Because they have reached a level called yaqeen. So scholars done takfir on them. They would drink khamar. They would do things that were muharramat. And when they are asked why, they won't pray salah. They won't pay zakat. They won't even go to the Kaaba. And some of them even claim whilst they're sitting at that particular place, they'll say to you, I went to the Kaaba and I came back. I just visited the Kaaba and I've just come back. And I saw Fulan ibn Fulan in the Kaaba and he was doing tawaf around the Kaaba. Salah. If you go back to don't go far. Go to Somalia, you see people like that who believe those stuff. I saw a guy one time, a large amount of women were with him. This guy's got an entourage of women. Like he's got over 30 women all running after him. Somalia. All of them are running after him. And they all call him Abu, Dad. Dad. He's got boys, men as well. Their entourage again, another 30, 40 entourage. Follow him. The women he marries, the way he deals with everything, the way he does things. لا يصلي. No one's ever seen him pray salah. He does not pray the salah. They all call him Dad. They respect him. If you ever say anything about him, أعوذ بالله, you'll be killed. You'll be murdered on the spot. You just have to watch everything that's happened. Because in that village, he's got everything on control. This is just one. Thousands of them are like that around the country. Go travel to Pakistan and India and countries like that. You guys is on YouTube, don't worry. Your stuff is on YouTube. The guy gets covered with some things and goes, it's on YouTube. They put a big cloth over him and he's doing this. You guys always take it a step further. He goes, he starts shaking the cloth at this point. So they say he's going to the Kaaba. He's going to the Kaaba, he's doing dawah around the Kaaba, and he's just sitting there and it reminds me of what's it called? Dragon Ball Z, huh? Teleportation, what's it called? When they just they go somewhere else, what's it called?
Transmission
wasn't the word, I'm sure.
Translocation, huh?
Anyways, that's what it is. The man goes to the Kaaba, does tawaf, does umrah, comes back, says Fulan was there. Fulan, I wouldn't even be shocked if it's true that he does do that. Because shayateen work with these people. They work with shayateen and things. I wouldn't be shocked if it's actually something, you know, that he's really finding out through working with the shayateen, who's gone there, who's not. The point is, this is the things that they adopted. So the ulama kaffaruhum, they made takfir on them. They made what? They made takfir on them. So books have been written, rasail have been written, they became very common around the Muslim world, in Africa, places in Africa like Sudan, They became very common. Somalia, they became very, even in Nigeria, Ghana, subcontinent, Asia, America. Well, Western countries, they're very weak. Very, very weak. Their influence is very weak. But countries that are poor, they got strength. They do things for the people. They feed the people. They take leadership positions where through that they can influence the people. Now,